ورسولنا وحبيبنا أفضل الصلاة والسلام على آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. So we want to begin today to pick up from the bab of studying about Salat al-Witr and the kayfiyah, how to perform Salat al-Witr. And we discussed the issue of 3 rak'ah and 1 rak'ah and how the best method, or the one that is continuous, and what we find in the most ahadith, in the athbat ahadith, is to make 3 rak'ah with tasleem after the 2 rak'ah. When you make 2 rak'ah, you make tasleem and you make 1 rak'ah. And this is what even Ibn Abul Izz al-Hanafi in his Sharaf al-Hidayah has mentioned this to be the rajih qawl with the most ahadith. Now, what do you recite during the qunut? So according to the ijma' and Imam al-Nabawi in his majmu' Ibn Qudama and Al-Mughni and others have mentioned ijma' of the ummah, that in the first rak'ah you read Surah Al-A'la. It's the 87th surah in the Quran. And the second rak'ah, Surah Al-Kafirun, which is the 109th surah in the Quran. And then if you make taslim or you do not, then the third rak'ah, you recite Surah Al-Ikhlas, the 112th surah of the Quran. The dalil is a sahih hadith reported by Imam al-Nisa'i, Ubay bin Ka'b radiallahu anhu, said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would recite in witr Surah Al-A'la, Subhismi Rabbika Al-A'la, in the first rak'ah, and in the second, he would recite Qul Yahu Al-Kafirun, in the third, Qul Hu Allahu Ahad, and this is a clear wadi hadith that the ulema relied upon. But also, in accordance to the ijma' of the ulema of Islam, this is not wajib. Yani if you use a different surah in witr, there's nothing wrong, there's no itham on you for this. But this is the regular way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do. It's the best way. But we know that if you switch up a surah from the Quran for the others after Al-Fatiha, there is no problem with that, because the surah after Al-Fatiha is mustahab. It is not from the arkan or wajibat. Now, what about the qunut in witr and how it's prayed? It's a very important lesson, because every one of you, inshallah, prays the witr and you have to use this. Here, Shaykh al-Islam Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama, he says the qunut supplication is recited in the third rak'ah after ruku'. This is what is an umda. What he's mentioning is how to perform it according to the Hanbali madhab. But there is khilaf even within the Hanabala, so we'll discuss the issue today. When we talk about qunut and when we talk about its recitation, there is 2 different types of recitation for qunut. One is the qunut al-nawazil or nazila, when there are calamities upon the ummah. And one is qunut al-witr, and that is done in the witr salah. Both times is called qunut, but there are some differences in ahadith, so we want to explain that. The qunut al-nawazil or nazila, it is supplicated in the time when there is a difficulty upon the ummah. As alhamdulillah in this masjid we did, for our brothers and sisters going through hardships in Burma. And this is from the sunnah, that if any part of the ummah is going through a hardship or is betrayed or killed, to make dua for them, to make the qunut and nazila for them. And you can make this in any of the salawat, in any of the 5 fard salawat. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did for a month in Fajr against the people who had killed the sahaba, the qurra, and we discussed that already in the seerah, durus. We do know sahih ahadith that you can make it in any of the 5 salawat. So you can make it, but this is with sabab. And the sabab is a calamity upon the ummah. The dalil for this is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, who said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he supplicated the qunut for a month in Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr. At the end of each of them, yani in the last rak'ah, and he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would make dua, and then he would make dua against Banu Sulaym and other tribes who had tricked the Muslims. We discussed this already. And because this is a sahih hadith, without doubt, this is a hukam, that any of the 5 salawat, you can make dua against the kuffar in him as well. Because we're not discussing qunut al-nawazil, we're not going to discuss that in detail, but I wanted to introduce this. Regards to the witr salah, and qunut in the witr salah, there is khilaf of ulama on how and when to recite it. And I'll mention all of the opinions as we can gather with the proofs and the books. The first opinion we'll discuss, and this is the opinion of the Hanafi Madhab, that according to the Ahnaf, Qunut al-Witr is wajib. Yani not only is the witr wajib, but making the dua of Qunut is wajib. Yani if you don't make it, the sujood sahu. It is performed throughout the year. According to the Ahnaf, every time you make witr, you should perform the Qunut dua. It is not restricted to any time like nawazin. It is done throughout the year, and it is done in this method. One, it prays, according to Ahnaf, the three raka'ah together without a taslim in the middle. In the third raka'ah, the person, he says takbir again, and he folds his hands below his navel, and he recites the dua, and then goes into ruku'. And according to the Ahnaf, in the third raka'ah witr, after you're finished with your second surah, you say Allahu Akbar again. And you tie your hands, you don't raise them in the way of the dua, you tie them and you recite the qunut, and then after you're done, then you go into ruku'. What is the reference? And I want to give references because I don't want to just say Hanafi say this, Shafi'i say this. If we look at Mukhtasar al-Quduri, the well-known Mu'tamid book, it says witr is three raka'ah, which does not separate with salam. And they're together. One recites dua of qunut in the third raka'ah before ruku' throughout the year. One recites al-fatiha, then another additional surah along with it in every raka'ah of witr. When one desires to perform qunut, he pronounces the takbir, raises his hands, he makes raf'u al-yadayn, and then recites the qunut. One does not recite the qunut in any salah other than it, except in the cases of nawazil. Yani, unless it's qunut al-nazila, the qunut of witr is only for witr here. With regards to the witr being wajib, we've already discussed this in the earlier dars, so I'm not going to go over this. The Jamhur al-Ulama did not consider it, and there are sari hadith that mention that it's not. With regards to the qunut being wajib in the witr, it's also something that the great ulema of the Ahnaf, many of them disagreed with the madhab on this issue. And the problem is, many of the people that teach the durus, they don't tell you about these things. They just tell you, in our madhab it's like this. But they don't tell you about those ulema that disagree with the madhab themselves. Like Ibn Hammam, the one who wrote Fath al-Qadir, the famous Sharh of Hidayah, the great Hanafi scholar, he said, the opinion of the qunut being wajib is a very weak opinion, and it is not proven by any evidence. And I have Fath al-Qadir in my house. So if anybody wants to see it or show it to somebody, I have it highlighted, I can give you. If you give it back. So this Hanafi alim, scholar of hadith, he says that to call the dua of qunut wajib in the witr salah, there is no dalil for this that is clear. And in fact, we'll discuss the dalil against considering it to be wajib. As for the qunut being before ruku', yani we discuss Ibn Qudama said after ruku', then there is the dalil, and it is a sahih hadith by Asim, who said, I asked Anas bin Malik about the qunut. Anas radiallahu anhu replied, definitely was recited. I asked before ruku' or after it. Anas radiallahu anhu said before ruku'. I added, so and so told me that you had informed them that it was after ruku'. Anas radiallahu anhu said, I was mistaken. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited qunut after ruku' for a period of 1 month. Anas radiallahu anhu added that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent 70 men who knew the Quran towards the pagans who were less than them in number, and then he mentioned the incident, and then he made the qunut for a period of 1 month, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to punish them. The hadith is sahih as reported by Al-Bukhari and others. And there are other supporting narrations like what Ibn Abi Shaybah has mentioned in Musannaf, and Ibn Hajar Asqalani in his Sharh of Sahih Muslim has mentioned them. With regards of performing the qunut, then it is reported by Imam Abu Yusuf, the great student of Imam Abu Hanifa, that Talha rahmatullah alayhi narrates that Ibrahim al-Nikha'i said, the hands will be raised in 7 places. At the beginning of Salah, at the beginning of qunut of witr, at the 2 Eids, the takbirat of the 2 Eids. And that's interesting for those who are Hanafi, that this is given, but then the Eid Salah, the Hanafi ulema today tell us that don't raise the hands with the takbirat. But this is the dalil given by them. And then when making the istihlam of the al-hajar, yani when you're making the ishara toward the hajar, and at Safa and Marwa, and at Arafa and Muzdalifa and Jabara. Hence, the hands to be raised in the beginning of salah, and this is something that we can discuss more in detail. But here, one does not raise them in the method of making dua, but rather raise them in the way of making the takbir in the qiyam. Ibrahim al-Nikhai, he used this as a narration, but as we can tell, he was not Ibrahim al-Nikhai, was a tabi'i. So this narration has that weakness right there. That's a saying of Ibrahim al-Nikhai that is not marfu'an. And that's why some of the Ahnaf presented this and a supporting evidence. He said the hands should not be raised besides in seven places: the takbirat, takbir of raising for salah, the takbir for qunut and witr, the two eids, yani takbirat of eid, when touching the Hajr Aswad, upon the Safa and Marwa, Muzdalifa, Arafa, and the two jamarat. Yet the Hanafi scholars of hadith, those Ahnaf that were scholars of hadith, they pointed that the wording is mistaken. And this is pointed out by Ibn Hammam in his famous Fath al-Qadir, and also Imam al-Zayla'i in his famous Takhrij of Nasab al-Raya, which is a Takhrij of al-Hidayah. And some other Ahnaf who criticize these narrations, mentioning that performing Qunut where al-Aini in his Sharh of al-Hidayah, which is called al-Binaya, Sharh al-Hidayah, has also criticized it. In fact, many of the scholars have reported different views about performing the Qunut, as a great Hanafi scholar Abu Yusuf reported as to disagree with this opinion, as Ibn Abidin in his Rad al-Muhtar, the famous Hanafi book, he has reported as well. The report from Abu Yusuf also reported from the great Hanafi scholar Imam Ibn Hamman in Fath al-Qadir. Ahmad Ibn Abi Imran, the scholar of fiqh, said, "I was informed by Faraj, the Mawla of Abu Yusuf, Imam Abu Yusuf, the scholar, the student of Abu Hanifa. He said, I saw Abu Yusuf when he made the qunut for witr, he would raise his hands in the way of supplicating for dua. Ibn Abi Imran, he said the narration from Faraj is authentic, is sahih, and a general proof for raising the hands for dua and in the qunut." Yani Imam Abu Yusuf, he took this not to mean that you raise it like in the way of takbir, but rather you raise them in the way of dua. Tayyib, the second opinion amongst the ulama of Islam, according to Shafi'i madhab, the qunut of witr is only performed in the second half of Ramadan. And that's why what surprises me is when people claim a madhab and know nothing about it. We go to some of the masajid and there were Shafi'i, and the Shafi'i, and Muhammad Idris is Shafi'i, and Shafi'i this, and Shafi'i all day long. But then in all of Ramadan they make qunut. And this is not the Shafi'i madhab. The Shafi'i madhab, the mu'tamid, even if it's a weak opinion, but this is the opinion of the madhab, is that the witr is not made all year long. It is only made in the second half of Ramadan. It is performed after ruku', there is no takbir for it, like the ahnaf, and the hands are raised as they would be for dua. And this is the mu'tamid of the Shafi'i madhab, as mentioned in Fath al-Allam, and Imam al-Nabawi in al-Majmu', he discusses this, and saying, he says, as for performing qunut of witr in the second half of Ramadan, then it is based on the following hadith. Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu, gathered the people in salah under the leadership of Ubay ibn Ka'ab, and they prayed together for 20 nights, and he did not make the qunut for except during the latter half of Ramadan. And we'll discuss this narration. As for performing qunut after ruku', then it is based on the sahih hadith reported in al-Bukhari, that Muhammad ibn Sirin reported from Anas bin Malik رضي عنه, that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, how did he, when he was asked how did he make the salah, he said he recited qunut in the Fajr salah. Anas replied in the affirmative. He said further, he was asked, did he recite before ruku'? He replied that he recited the qunut after ruku'. Now the problem with using this as a dalil is that it is regarding qunut al-nazil, because it's discussing Fajr. But khair, this is the opinion that's put forward. The third opinion, and that is the opinion of the Hanabila, the Hanbali madhab, is that it is preferred to recite the qunut in witr after ruku' in the same method described by the Shafi'i madhab. The key difference between the Hanabila and the Shafi'i here is the Hanabila say the qunut is not restricted to the second half of Ramadan. It can be made all year long. And This is clearly stated by in Umda, as we've discussed this from Ibn Qudama, who says Qunut supplication in the third rak'ah after ruku'. This is also reported in the relied upon book Dalil al-Talib and Zad al-Mustaqni' of the Hanabila. Zad al-Mustaqni' states the lowest number for witr is 3 rak'ah with 2 taslim. Yani 2 rak'ah, then you make salam, and you make 1 rak'ah for witr and Surah Al-A'la in the first rak'ah, Al-Kafirun in the second, Surah Ikhlas in the third, and the Qunut is made after ruku'. This is in Zad al-Mustaqni'. Although the Hanabila prefer performing Qunut after ruku', they do not reject the practice of performing Qunut before ruku'. Because the usul from the Hanabila is not to reject anything established in Sahih Ahadith. Since both of them have authentically reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they're both accepted. The great Hanbali scholar, Shaykh al-Islam, Taqiyuddin Abu al-Abbas ibn Taymiyyah, in Majmu' al-Fatawa, he writes, with regards to Qunut, there are two extreme views and one moderate view. Some say the Qunut should only be recited before ruku', and some say that it should only be recited after ruku'. The fuqaha amongst the scholars of hadith, such as Imam Ahmad and others, said that both are allowed because both are mentioned in the Sahih Sunnah, but they preferred reciting Qunut after ruku' because this was mentioned more often. What does that mean? The akthar ahadith, the more ahadith mentioned it after ruku', so this was the preference, but making it before ruku' or after was accepted by the fuqaha from the ulama of hadith and the Hanabila. Raising the hands, tayyib. Now making takbir and raising the hands like the way of salah is not mentioned in any sahih ahadith. So to say Allahu Akbar to raise them, we don't have a sahih hadith for this, and if anybody can prove it, we'd love to see it. But what about raising the hands in the method of dua, in the method of making dua? For this, we don't have any sahih hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What we do have is a sahih hadith from Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu, as Al-Bayhaqi has reported and classified as sahih. Imam al-Bukhari in Juz Raf al-Adain has also reported it. And this is something that is a dalil. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِالسُنَّةِ وَالسُنَّةُ الْخُلَفَاءَ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِينَ. And we studied in Usul al-Fiqh that if a Sahabi does an action and it is not contradictory to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam or contradicted by other Sahaba, then it's a hujjah, especially from the Khulafa. So Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu, it is reported that he raised his hand in the method of dua when he was performing the Qunut. And because there's no Sahabi that mentioned that he didn't, or they didn't, and it's not contradicted, like there's no hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't raise his hands, so this becomes a hujjah. So for us, when the Qunut is going on, you should raise the hands. This is a hujjah from Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu. Even if some of the ulama said this was for Qunut al-Nazila, but because for Qunut al-Witr, you don't have a khilaf for it. So there is tashbih in this issue. Now what about those ulama that said you fold the hands? Ibn Hammam and Az-Zayla'i and others, they said that there is no hadith at all, not sahih and not da'if, for folding the hands in Qunut. But what is the dalil for folding the hands for the Ahnaf? Ibn Hammam and others, they said that because the way of adab, of good etiquette, to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to fold the hands. So any time there is a dhikr, which is masnoon, yani from the sunnah, you should fold the hands in salah. Now my question, you can take this back to the Hanafi ulama that you may know, that if this is the dalil, that masnoon dhikr, when it is done, you must fold the hands, then why is it that after ruku', when you say Rabbana wa lakal hamd, and that is a dhikr, and it's masnoon, and you're standing, you don't fold the hands there? And that's why many of the Ahnaf, they said yes, even after ruku', and the Ahnaf, you can look at Fathul al-Qadir or Az-Zayla'i in Nasab al-Raya, many major scholars of the Hanafi madhab, especially those from Balkh, they took the opinion that after ruku' the hands have to be folded, because they said you're making a masnoon dhikr, and this is the adab of salah. Khair, with regards to witr, We don't have any hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Sahaba specific to the witr to fold the hands. What they say, we use the am for the regular salah. But we say that there is a specific khas hadith from Umar ibn Khattab, from a Khalifa al-Rashid, specifically for witr, that he used to raise the hands. So we cannot go to the am when you have a khas. So what is stronger is that the hands should be raised. Now when we talk about before ruku or after, let's discuss some of the dalail. Asim reported that he asked Anas bin Malik radiyallahu about qunut. He replied, definitely it was recited and it was before ruku or after it. He said, before ruku. Muhammad ibn Sirin said that Anas radiyallahu was asked, the same sahabi, did Rasulullah recite the qunut? He said, in Fajr. He replied, in the affirmative. He said, did he do it before or after? He replied, after. The conclusion, Sheikh Muhammad Saleh ibn Uthaymeen, in his sharh of Zad al-Mustaqni', he said, according to the most number of ahadith and according to the opinion of the Jamhur, the majority of the ulema of Islam, al-Qunut should be after ruku'. But if a person recites it before ruku', then this is permissible. A person has the choice to recite the Qunut before, when he has finished from the Quran, when he stands up from ruku' and says, Rabbana wa laka alhamd, then he may recite the Qunut as described in most of the ahadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is the opinion of the Jamhur. This is close to the opinion of the Maliki Madhab, as Ibn Abi Zayd mentioned in his famous Ar-Risala, the Matan in Maliki Fiqh. He said, one can recite Qunut after doing ruku', although you can, if you want, recite it before ruku', after finishing your recitation of the Quran. Rashid al-Hassan, he mentioned one may offer the supplication of Qunut before ruku', after completing the Quran. In this case, the worshipper, he recites the Qunut supplication without preceding it with takbir, without saying Allahu Akbar. After finishing the Qunut, he says Allahu Akbar and goes into ruku'. The evidence for offering Qunut after ruku' is found in Sahih Muslim, and the evidence for doing it before ruku' is also found in Sunan al-Nisa'i and Ibn Majah and other books of hadith. However, offering Qunut after ruku' is preferred because the ahadith regarded are more in number. Also, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do this at the most often time, and that was reported from the Khulafa al-Rashidun. It is permissible for one's hands in Qunut to be raised, as we see from the Khalifa al-Rashid Umar radiyallahu used to do. The issue of Qunut is something flexible in these issues. It should not make the Ummah separate from each other. As for raising the hands, we already mentioned the hadith from Umar bin Khattab, and this is something that is in evidence because Imam Ahmad has also reported it marfu'an from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and if there is da'af in that, it's supported by the sahih hadith of Umar bin Khattab. As Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen writes, the way in which the hands should be raised, the scholars of Islam said, is that the hands should be raised to the chest level. The hands should be raised to the chest level, with them not raise them very much. Like you see some of the people in Qunut, their hands are very high, not doing it in that way in Qunut. In other times, there are mentions of Rasulullah's arms being shown, but that's at a different time. And he should spread his palms and hold them facing towards the sky. And the apparent meaning, as the scholars have mentioned, is to indicate that he is putting them together like a beggar asking for something, as we are asking the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the goodness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As far as holding them far apart, I know of no basis for that from the Sunnah or the words of the scholars. So what does Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen say? Is what the ulama have mentioned, the hands are raised during Qunut around the level of the chest. And it's not something where there's clear you must do it, but this is what it should be. Close together with the palms facing the sky. Some people, they raise it very high or spread them apart. We do not know of this to be from the works of the scholars or anything from the Sunnah. Sheikh Rashid Hassan also offers a valuable advice. He says the Muslims should be concerned to avoid unnecessary disagreement and splitting on this issue, because all of the things that are mentioned in Sahih Ahadith can be accepted. Ibn Qudama has mentioned a similar advice when he writes, those who differ with us in mentions of fiqh, like the Maliki and Hanafi and Shafi'i, they can lead us in Salah, then we pray behind them and the Salah is valid and not makruh. Understand? If somebody is Hanafi, they pray behind a Shafi'i, and the Shafi'i prays according to the Shafi'i madhab. This is not makruh, there's nothing wrong with this. This is jaiz, this is valid. And those who say you cannot beg behind this and that are only splitting the ummah until we see this condition that happened in the ummah and people are making 4 salawat in the haram. May Allah protect us from that. Now, regarding the dua of qunut, then there are different wordings that are mentioned. Allahumma adin fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallani fi man tawallayt, and other wordings. Everything that is authentically reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for qunut can be used, and there is no problem with that. With regards to making it only in the second half of Ramadan, the issue with that is, first, there is da'if. This hadith is da'if. Secondly, it is reported from Umar bin Khattab, khalif to what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has done. There are a hadith where Rasulullah made witr and he made the qunut. And there are a hadith where Rasulullah made witr and the qunut is not mentioned. So what is rajih is that you can make the qunut in the witr, or you can make witr without it. Both ways have been reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you make qunut in your witr sometimes, it's good. If you leave it at sometimes, there's no problem. It's better to do it. There is more thawab. But if somebody makes a witr without qunut, as has been reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's no problem with that. Qunut can be made all year round. To make it only for the second half of Ramadan, as the Shawafi have done, is not based on clear sahih dalail, and it's khalif to the sahih ahadith that mention it throughout with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this will end the dars on witr, and inshallah we'll continue the fiqh of salah next time. Jazakumullahu khairan.